I wasn't there. It'll happen next month, the second Thursday of the month. I don't know what that is, but it'll happen. You'll be apprised of it. And with that, take it away.
It's time to get our worship going with some music. So let's all rise if you are willing. Our first song this morning is going to be Giving It All to You.
Thank you.
I will follow. This is an old hymn, so I think a lot of us will be familiar with it. So we're going back in days.
We are the Village Church.
When we gather in community, we remember that God is with us. We know that we are imperfect people who make mistakes. We give thanks that God loves us anyway. In this community, we practice patience, compassion, and forgiveness. When we leave this gathering, we go out to share God's healing love with a broken world. We are Jesus' instruments of hope in our world. We are followers of Jesus, and we can change the world.
Friends, the late Rabbi Edwin Friedman, who's also a family therapist, and that's really the season of his work, he tells a story about desire. A man who, and sorry, this is a very sexist story, but I'm going to say it like he says it. A man who shares his home with his wife, his children, his in-laws, and his animals, goes to the rabbi and says, "Rabbi, Rabbi, my house is a hell. My wife nags about everything I do and I don't do. My children never listen to me, and my in-laws don't respect me. And my animals, they are so noisy, and they leave my house in a mess. I don't know what to do. Rabbi, please, please tell me something that I can do." So the rabbi pauses, looking at the man intently, and he says, "Ah, fine. I know exactly what you should do. Go home and remove your wife from your home. Then everything will be perfect." And so he goes home and he removes his wife from his house. A week later, the man comes back and he says, "Rabbi, Rabbi, my house is a bit better. It's a bit better, but my children, they're driving me crazy. They still don't listen to me. They talk bad." And so the rabbi says, "All right, I'll tell you what to do. Go home and turn your children out onto the street. Then your home will be like heaven." And so he goes home and he packs up his kids and he puts them out on the street. A week later, the man comes back to the rabbi and says, "Rabbi, Rabbi, it's almost heaven in my house. But my in-laws, they're mad at me. Everything I do, they find fault with it. Please, please tell me what to do." Rabbi thinks a bit, stroking his spirit. He says, "I know exactly what you will do. I know it will bring peace to your heart and peace to your home. Go home, pack up all your in-laws' belongings, and put them out into the street. Just turn them out." So the man goes back home. He packs up his in-laws and all their things. He puts them out in the street. A week later, the man comes back to the rabbi. And he says, "Rabbi, Rabbi, it is almost just like you said. It's almost heaven, almost peaceful in my home. But my animals, there's crap everywhere. I don't know what to do." So the rabbi thought again, "Okay, all right, okay, I'm getting there. Pack up all of your animals and all their stuff, turn them out into the street, and then your house will be as you wish." A week later, again, the man comes back to the rabbi and he says, "Rabbi, I am so lonely. I miss my wife and I miss talking to her. I miss her smell. I miss my kids and all of the noise they make and the hundreds of times they call me and do nothing what I ask them to do. And I miss my in-laws, the wisdom and the love and the care and the support that they gave me. I miss them. And I'm hungry. I am not a good cook. Please, Rabbi, tell me what to do." And so the rabbi said, "I know exactly what you need to do. Go home. Win the heart of your wife back. Bring her back into your home. Apologize. And your life will be like heaven." And then you can suspect, intimate what the rest of that is. He goes back the next week and things are a little bit better. And the rabbi tells him to go and get his kids. And then he goes back again. And the rabbi says, "Go get your in-laws." He gets the in-laws. He goes goes back again. The rabbi tells him to go and get his animals. And everybody's back into the house. Who hasn't felt something like that in their own life? The love and peace and contentment and fulfillment that this man in the story thought he wanted, he already had. He already had it. He just needed to learn how to love it again. How to mind the things that needed to be taken care of and to leave the stuff that didn't need to be taken care of, because there are things that you cannot manage. Friends, the church in Corinth, Greece was rich like this man in more ways than one. And they didn't know it. They were rich numerically, financially, organizationally, in leadership, and even in spiritual gifts. They were one of the earliest gatherings of the new religious movement that Jesus and the apostles started. They had everything. They had everything going for them. They had everything that they needed to grow and nurture one another. And why Paul wrote this letter and said these things to them and the subsequent things, we'll talk about that in a subsequent sermon. But for now, let's just reflect on the words now that he writes in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 1 to 9. And they say, Paul is introducing himself, called to be an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, and your brother Sosthenes, these are the people writing. To the church of God that is in Corinth, to those who are sanctified, set apart, special in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, together with all those who are in every place, who in every place call on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, both their Lord and ours. Grace to you, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to God always for you, because of the grace that God has given to you in Christ Jesus. For in every way you have been enriched in him, in speech and knowledge of every kind, just as the testimony of Christ has been strengthened among you, so that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift as you wait for the revealing of Jesus Christ our Lord. Will also strengthen you to the end, so that you may be blameless on the day of the Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful. God is faithful. By him you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Many of you sitting in this room have been here since the founding of the Village Church. And if not, maybe you came shortly thereafter. So looking back, you can remember all the work that went into organizing it. The meetings, the paperwork, the invitations you sent out by word, by mouth, by invitation, personal invitation, to come and visit us and see what we're about on a Sunday morning. You remember what it took and even what it takes make this service and all of its mission outreaches happen. And looking back, you can recall that some of you probably thought that you didn't have the skill to do church. Maybe you had been away from church for a long time, and maybe this was your biggest hesitation to jump back in because of all the things that you had endured, experienced in another church setting. But nevertheless, it happened, and it's happening now. What you thought you couldn't do, you did. What you thought you didn't know, you figured out. And the material stuff that you needed, you found a way to get. No mean feat, no small stuff, nothing to sneeze at. So give yourselves a hand. Bumps and missteps and some challenges along the world. often the challenges and changes that life and religious community give. The word, friends, for us today from Paul is that we have been enriched in Jesus Christ, in God, in speech and knowledge of every kind. We have it. As a church, we have been enriched with everything that we need, and that we are not lacking in any spiritual gift. We're not. But there's another but, and there always seems to be another but in Scripture. It is the case that we don't have the presence of mind to perceive and seize every single gift to which we have been called to do this work here in this space, and also on behalf of the kingdom of God. Rather, the conditions have been set for us to discern these gifts and to live into them. Maybe our role has been changed. Maybe our energy has flagged. Maybe people, obviously, they come and they go. And figuring out what needs to be done is harder today than it was yesterday, or a month ago, or a couple of years ago. Maybe life in this space, how we shape it, has changed. And that's what we need to figure out. Friends, indeed, the soil in which we have been planted on this quarter and all the other quarters that this church existed on is still rich and fertile. God's good news of Jesus Christ is still there. We still need to hear it again, and we still need to live into it. We do, and I do believe that we still have a clear sense of what we've been called to do, to be bread and light and a cup of cold water and salt to this world. Most of you are United Methodists, so what did John Wesley ask us to do? Do all the good you can by all the means you can, in all the ways you can, in all the places you can, at all times that you can, to all the people can, as long as ever you can. That's from one of your guys. And I think that sums up 1 Corinthians 1 through 9, the giving of gifts already not realized. I think that's what the message for us this morning in this room. I think it sums it up nicely. What in the world is Paul, John Wesley, calling us to do? They want us to, again, recognize under what efforts we do this work. It's called sapiential eschatology. Don't worry about it. Or realized eschatology. If you guys are Bible study students, you know all about the apocalypse, and this is going to happen, and that's going to happen, and this terrible thing's going to happen, and all of these things are happening, flow into one another and work like clockwork. I think Paul, my interpretation of Paul, and I think John Wesley is telling us to understand that all that stuff, that may or may not be true, I don't know, is what God desires for us and for all people, for the coming in, continual coming in of the kingdom is all about right now, as we open ourselves up to see and think anew and do things in a new way, in ways that we don't want to, we would want to, with whomever, wherever, under what circumstances. That's how the kingdom of God comes. That's how we see into the future. That's how we walk. Continually asking for a vision again to see what it is before us that we need to say or do or think. gifts that are talked about in Scripture are never ever given in total to a congregation. They come to us as we fellowship together, as we work and do ministry together, as we struggle together, as we care for one another together, and as we see the context that we are in, then we make change. God acts with us. And maybe God is waiting for us to act. We don't know unless we think, discern, look and see what the context is around us. The Village Church has indeed changed over the last 7 years, and I can only imagine because I've only been here for 3 months. A word from Paul, I think, is in order. Now is the time for the Village Church to discern and to reflect of the who, the what, the when, the why, and the where. Not of its calling. No, that never changes. To be light and salt and water to the world. That doesn't change. But on the what, the who, the where, the how, and the when of its ministry. What does it look like? Its length, its breadth, its texture, tenor of it, and with whom and where. Friends, we already have what we want. It only gets better as we lean into discernment where we are now, what it is we need to do, how we gather up our skirts and our pants and move where the wind, where the Spirit of God is blowing us. We already have the kernels and the seeds and the germs of our ministry, the gifts that we need to do our ministry. We only need to open our eyes and look deep. Be brave and follow God who's already gone before us. Let's pray. Gracious God, we just pray that where you lead us, we will follow. In the garden, in the judgment, and Lord, we venture to follow you into that new future that you have for us. So Lord, show us the way. We want to see you and we want to be found worthy of our calling and we want to be found busy doing the things that you want us to do for the sake of your kingdom. A manifestation that's already in this room and into the future. So Lord, open our eyes that we may see marvelous things that we don't even know of. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Okay. to this table. This is God's table. Spread not only for us, but for the whole world. Those who confess Christ as Lord. See God as reflected in the life and death, the burial and the resurrection of Jesus Christ is welcomed at this table. At this table we find life and hope and healing and joy and peace and wholeness. God pursues us even now, even as we in times past, even our ancestors, have tried to get away and fashion our own lives and do things our own way. God pursues us down to this minute in Jesus Christ, our life reflected in His, on how to bend the will of God that is always gracious, always good, always calming, always gentle. So friends, come as you are willing and able to receive whatever you need at this moment from these small gifts of bread. Gracious God, we give you thanks that you are Lord of all time and space, all people. You are Lord of the church wherever it is. The church triumphant, those who have gone before us in times past. This church now gathered, this congregation, churches all across this world. And Lord, those who are yet to be born into this world. Thank you that you are Lord of all and in control of all. So Lord, continue to draw us by your Spirit's tether to see and hear anew from these gifts of bread and wine, simple gifts, but powerful enough to open eyes, to open arms, to open mouths, to move feet and hands. Bless these things, Lord, as you already have, to our bodies, so that we can go out to be the bread and the wine, the healing bread and wine that this world needs. Thank you for leading us to this table, to which you have us celebrate. We ask these in Christ's name. Friends, come, this table is for you. Come now and receive new life. Other people through our own labor and even just out of serendipity. Thank you. Thank you for family and for friends, for the jobs that we have, the homes that we live in, the things that we need and want to make our lives that much more rich and simple and convenient. Thank you for these gifts and other gifts. Thank you for this world in which you have put us, abundant with so many things to look at and experience and sense with all of our senses. Thank you for that, all of it. Lord, we do ask your blessings upon Jim as he is preparing himself even now for this surgery. Bless and guide the hands of the doctor and the nurses as they attend to him. Even now, calm Sherry and Shelley's heart and the hearts of her family members and friends. And Lord, help us to remember on Wednesday to be praying for this dear brother. Lord, may your will be done. May he be well and whole. Return home in better health. Lord, you already know that there are concerns, joys that we hold in our hearts that we haven't written down, that we sort of want to keep close to our chest. So we offer those up to you, those things that are of concern to us. You know them all completely, so Lord, the only thing that we ask is that you bless and that you heal and that you give enlightenment and that you touch and that you soothe and that you help us to be. By your Spirit, speak to us the words that we need to hear at the moment that we need to hear them through the voice that you choose. We look into another week full of possibility and promise. Keep us steady. Keep us grounded in your promise of never being left alone. But guide our thoughts and guide our actions. Help us to think twice as much as we speak. But Lord, may our speaking be salt and sweet. May it be your word. Whatever situation it is, Lord, guide our feet and guide our hearts. Guide the feet and heart of your whole church as we await your kingdom, as we act so that your kingdom comes day by day, moment by moment, wherever we are. These and other things we ask in the strong name of your Son. Thank you. although I'm not opposed.
Thank you.